I'm Commander Shepard, and VGS is my favorite show on the Citadel.
This is 3Dog!
How can I help?
This week on VGS, we have a show that is at a very important time in the world of gaming. Very rarely, probably every 4 years, like the Olympics, there is a new console that comes out. And this weekend, we have a new one. It is named by the gods a Switch. It is created by some of the forebears of all games. And it is portable, expensive, doesn't have a lot of features. And millions of people own one. The Nintendo Switch went out for sale officially on Friday. $400 price tag for us Canucks. And some of the reviews for the killer app, the main game, Zelda. What's the game called exactly? The Zelda game
called? Breath of the Wild.
Zach Fanny joining us, Professor Fanny. Breath of the Wild, Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, has scored at last check on Metacritic. This is checking on Sunday. 10 perfect 10s from major publications. There are very few games that have reached that. Even so, today on the show, we're going to take you through whether or not we think it's a good purchase. We've talked about that before, but I do want to take some time to discuss an avenue of it that we are very excited for, Zach. There's something called Nindies, because Nintendo needs to be weird and different. They're just indie games for Nintendo, right? And when we talked about the Switch, because everyone in here in this room got a chance to play it, mm-hmm. I'm joined, of course, by Professor Fanny and Thomas, pressing the buttons here today.
Hello.
Wonderful job. We've all been
doing swell.
What was I supposed to say?
Fair enough. We're all. Can you give me some water, by the way, Thomas?
No, not at all.
Okay. All right. We'll talk about this. Well, the break's coming up.
That's
soon.
Not what your intern's for.
So the Nintendo Switch, we talked about it before. There's one killer app that people really want, Legend of Zelda. If that isn't your game, the indies might be. And that's what we're really hoping for. We're going to talk about that later in the show. We're also talking about Bolivia, which we always try to cover at least once in the program.
After finding out it exists.
Yeah, at least one time. Yeah. You know it's a real place? Thomas, did you know that?
I had never heard that, actually.
Really?
It's not like a chewing gum. I want to get Hunter and have him point it out to us on a map.
Oh, man. Yeah, so we will also have Hunter and Travis, our residents, Tweedledee and Tweedledum, respectively, talking about news of the week a little bit later, because there is some pretty interesting news. If you have a Nintendo Switch, don't put those cartridges in your mouth. Should be common knowledge, but apparently it can make you vomit instantly. And then later in the show, I am going to tell you why Mass Effect Andromeda, the game we talk about literally every week, has finally secured not my $60, not my $70, my $100 to $200. I want the extra extreme edition because I think this game might blow my mind. This is VGS. Zach, what have you been playing this week?
Horizon Zero Dawn came out, so I took all those exams I was going to mark and burned them. And
all right, kids at Humber College. Yeah. So, yeah, if you go to our YouTube video game sophistry, you'll see about 875 videos on Horizon Zero Dawn. Big thanks to Anton for helping us.
And we both love the world itself, right? Like, it's all kind of built really well from a sociological point of view. There's mm-hmm. motivations for every kind of tradition and ritual, and like characters conflict with the societies they're born into. Like, it's incredible.
I love the idea, because everyone, if you're listening to the show, you probably like storytelling a little bit, because we focus a lot on that. Mm-hmm. Horizon Zero Dawn shows you the talent that people have, and when you give them an opportunity, they can make things that'll resonate like Star Wars, like Lord of the Rings. And I think Horizon Zero Dawn, for me, I'm really deep into it now, mm-hmm. is kind of at that Mass Effect level for me when it first came out. So we absolutely loved it, and there's tons of stuff on it. Like, we were talking beforehand, before the show started, that this game kind of sneaks in some incredible characters that deal with complex gender identities.
Yeah, it's again, kind of, I guess games are the best situated in terms of the mediums to really explore like non-traditional identities in a meaningful way, especially with like the fantastical environments that you're in and whatnot. And that happens here. Like, it's kind of taking like the BioWare Dragon Age pattern and fulfilling that in a really interesting way.
I would even say that it takes it a step further, because it shows it not necessarily as something that needs to be coveted and protected and look what we're doing here, but just another part of the game.
Right.
The same way that you have a character that's barbarous and, you know, has these different character ideas, Barbara is probably not the greatest example when you're talking about weird gender identity, but we just have more complex and interesting characters. And any game that can do that well, I love. And this game, for me, has done it the best. Thomas Hyde, what have you been playing?
Well, AOL, America Online, have released, to promote the new Ben-Hur movie coming out, they released a Ben-Hur chariot racing game for free on the Xbox One. Played a little bit of that, and let me tell you, that game is a doozy. Look out Breath of the Wild, look out Horizon Zero Dawn, because I know who's winning all the game awards this year, and it's the new Ben-Hur promotional game.
Outdated game from an outdated book from an outdated movie.
All right, I think we're going to take a quick break now. Thomas Hyde just killing all of it. Just basically, like, the energy, the flow, the beauty, everything that's important to me.
The black hole of
Thomas Hyde is the black hole of art. We're going to be back after this. Got those new liners, eh? Oh, sounded good when he says my name. Andy Burkowski here for VGS, joined, of course, by Mr. Zach Fanny, the illustrious Thomas Hyde, the black hole of creativity, as he's known around here. We're talking Nintendo Switch. We're talking Mass Effect. Every week is Mass Effect until it comes out. And probably even for many of the sequential weeks after
that. We'll see in 2020.
Yeah, maybe 2020. Yeah. We won't have but it's going to be another franchise. So,
yeah,
this is the Mass Effect show. and we're talking about Bolivia later, so it should be very exciting. Before we get to all of that, though, it's always important when you listen to this, maybe you're big in the world of games, maybe you're not, and you want to be reminded if one of those major titles is coming out. We're here to help you with a little bit of Tom Jones.
What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa. What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, 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 whoa.
Always bring him in from Vegas. I've been saying that joke for, I think, let's play a bit, close to 70 weeks.
Has it done the full circle of, like,
it's funny now because,
yeah,
ironically,
and then just becomes a black hole of hilarity.
Black hole of nothingness, Thomas Hyde.
We are really, this is the Neil deGrasse Tyson show.
It is.
Black holes.
So, games coming out on March 7th on PS4, Xbox One, and PC. Ghost Recon Wildlands. It is a Ubisoft title, and Hunter, what's his last name? Carson, I think it is. He's one of our interns here. He has written his magnum opus about this game, something that he believed really represents him as a person. So we promised him that he would read. He did a little research for us. So Zach Fanny, Professor Fanny, if you could take that away, please.
Dear Mother, Andy said some kind words to me today. I'll cherish them.
All right, come on, all right.
So after two betas and much anticipation, Tom Clancy's new open-world tactical team-based breath.
Just he wrote that in breath. Yeah.
Okay, I got the breath. Okay. Third-person shooters finally out. Available to play entirely in either solo or four-player co-op. Players will take a stealthy and surgical approach to their tactics as they combat the Bolivian-based Santa Blanca drug cartel.
You will play as the Ghosts. In parentheses, not from Call of Duty, an elite U.S. Special Forces team are sent behind enemy lines to wreak havoc, destabilize, and eventually break the alliance between the cartel and their country's corrupt government. So there we go. We had a lot of fun playing this game in the beta. Zach, Thomas, you missed out on that, unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
But we did have one of the other interns with us, Anton Mac. If you missed out on our conversation with it, really had to the YouTube Video Game Sophistry, because kudos to Hunter, he did a really beautiful reenactment of what happened to
the
us
funniest
when we
moment.
Played.
Yeah,
that on top of his magnum opus.
That on top, so he's got a lot going for him right now. But what am I referring to, Fanny? Just for those that missed it or they want to get reacquainted.
So we had this beautiful moment where we are sailing into the sunset on a helicopter.
Yeah.
And it was really cool because this is like the first helicopter we got in the game. Mm-hmm. We're like, we can fly helicopters.
What?
And so you're fighting people on the ground. And I'm like, okay, Anton jumps out, starts shooting people. I fly off, have some fun.
Yeah.
Don't help at all. They go, guys, we need some help. Anton's down. I'm like, okay, easy. I fly in. I lower the chopper right on the mountaintop where he's sniping from. Yeah. I jump out. I heal him. Like, hey, let's get in the helicopter and go to Andy.
Some real epic moments.
We're
real
just
exciting.
Like, we're killing it. All the mechanics are coming together. I feel like I'm actually part of, you know, SEAL Team 6. Mm-hmm. We jump in the helicopter. We start to, you know, lift off the ground. And then I'm like, okay, what's the change seat button? Oh, wait, I'm the driver. And so I hop out at a safe height and land on the ground. I'm like, oh, Anton. And the helicopter keeps rising. You're still in there, Anton. He's like, wait, what? And it just starts spinning.
Off, into the heavens.
Into the heavens, like into the sun. And Anton, we just hear him go, ah.
Yeah, because we're listening to him play. So that... Oh my God! Was one of the funnier moments we've had.
It just, or just, you know, oh man, I can get in a trunk for some reason. I'm gonna do that. And you're like, oh wait, what's this button do? C4'd me in the trunk. Car exploded.
So there's tons of fun moments with that, but unfortunately, the March 7th date doesn't work. I think with a lot of gamers' pocketbooks, because people have pocketbooks. They either just got Horizon Zero Dawn.
I'm balancing my checkbook, and that Tom Clancy budget just isn't what it used to be.
Horizon Zero Dawn came out last week. The Switch came out a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
And 2 weeks from now, Mass Effect Andromeda comes out.
So if you're an employed human being,
yeah,
you're not going to need Tom Clancy until, like, you know, the end of summer.
I don't know who would be buying this game, and it's a shame because if it was just a few months later, they already had, like, this is a Ubisoft title, they already had For Honor, and that kind of fizzled out a little bit. People really like it who like it, so that's great. But it's a shame that it has this placement here, I think. Yeah. All right, we're going to be back in a moment. We need, of course, our daily dose of news of the week.
This week in gaming.
I've got to do the news!
Break open your piggy banks, kids. The Nintendo Switch is now available everywhere. With a $400 price point and one big killer app,
Zelda Breath of the Wild,
everything is great and the world is at peace. Despite the nearly perfect reviews for Zelda Market Research Group, SuperData expects that it'll be a relatively slow start for the Switch with only 5 million units by the end of the year. To make a comparison, when the PlayStation 4 was released in 2013, over a million units were sold the first day.
In response to Nintendo Switch owners bizarrely trying to eat their own Switch cartridges, Nintendo revealed the Switch game cards have a non-toxic bitterness called denatonium benzoate to stop players from trying to consume their video games.
I swear to God.
This is mostly regarding the younger Nintendo crowd, so they don't accidentally digest their newly owned Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. You know, that old story. It looks like Ubisoft's new Ghost Recon Wildlands may be under some serious legal trouble. A formal complaint has been filed by the government of Bolivia against the French embassy, stating that they find the depiction of their country within the game to be highly inaccurate. The French embassy has yet to respond on the complaint, while the Bolivian government is on record saying that they would prefer to first solve the issue through diplomatic negotiation. Why Ubisoft didn't just set the title in a fictional country like Far Cry 4 is anyone's guess.
Overwatch has a new hero, and no, it's not Doomfist, yet.
Would you like my analysis of the situation?
Arisa, the new tank hero in Overwatch. She has a machine gun arm, an orb to draw on opponents to take them out, and a barrier that'll definitely keep the opposing team at bay. Her ultimate gives her team a major boost in attack stats. For the time being, Arisa should be more than enough to keep the Overwatch hype train going. You're listening to VGS on AM 640. We'll be back right after this.
This is VGS with Andy Barkowski on Talk Radio, AM 640.
I got a question. If you're in a workplace, maybe it's late, you're putting in the hours, maybe it's a Sunday even, past 7 o'clock.
Oh, are you talking about something specific?
Wow, that was bad.
Oh God,
it's almost like it's late on a Sunday.
I don't even want to continue with my anecdote. That was phenomenal to see. If you want to check this out, go to Video Game Sophistry on YouTube, and you can see that in all its glory. It happens.
I don't have a tongue anymore. I swallowed it.
It happens.
A car crash as a mouth.
It is. So here's my quandary. It's late on a Sunday. You're in a workplace. You find some normal, like a banana.
Just a lone banana.
A lone banana. Do you? And it's a workplace, so you know it's not. It's not on the streets. It's not a drug banana. Do you A, eat it? Just throw away the evidence. B, leave it alone because it's errant fruit on the ground, and you're not a foraging creature. Or C, see if it's someone's banana and ask permission.
A,
you just eat it. Throw away the peel.
Well, and that's a great comedy goof as well, because obviously someone's going to slip on it. It'll be hilarious.
And maybe stutter when they talk on a radio
Probably.
Show. What would you do, Zach Fanny?
I'd really want to do A, but if people were watching me, I'd feel compelled to do C.
That's what this man just did. Professor Fanny found a banana, said, is this anyone's? And then went into the other room, asked Travis if it was his, and then you'd lost my banana.
It's Travis's banana.
It is. Anyways. You're not here to listen about bananas. You're here to listen about the Nintendo Switch. That's crazy that you heard in News of the Week that if you put the cartridges in your mouth, it feels like you're going to vomit.
It's a 1 out of 5 mouthfeel. It's going to lower my rating.
It makes sense. It's a game for kids, and it's a game system for kids. They might be throwing those things in their mouths. I wonder, I want to be in that boardroom when they said, like, listen, this has got to taste bad. Make it happen.
I bet they list that under features, too.
It's like listen, boss, for years I've been working on this, you know, crappy tasting application for game cartridges. Can we finally put this into motion,
and
please?
We finally found a place for disgusting game cartridges. Hey, this just makes me want to eat all my other games, though, really. Like, what's a point of comparison? What's a PS4 game taste like?
Delicious.
Dreamcast snacks for later. All right. So, Nintendo Switch is out. People are losing their mind for The Legend of Zelda. It's getting tens across the board. We talked about before. Fanny, you and I, not really buying the hype just because I was actually brought up on Zelda, but the art style... Yeah, surprisingly. I know, this still created this type of human being. But the art style just... It's really not doing it for me. And just the mechanics, we played a bit of it at the Switch event. It is not why I want to get into this game.
It's not for us. Like, there's nothing about that game, honestly, appeals to me. And I don't want to be the constant naysayer with everything.
You really do a good job of not being the constant naysayer.
I'm trying. You know, new year, new me. I'll try it.
Something to get excited about, though. Nintendo this week did something they call Nindies. God, don't you just hate, like, corporations? Like, don't you just really hate?
Hey, we should make these cartridges real bitter, guys.
Yeah.
Let's call them carts.
Yeah, we got to call them these cool little branded names.
Don't put the ridge in your mouth.
That's it. You want to be a winner? Fuel like one. Anyway, it's actually kind of cool because they're having indie games. When we talked about the Switch for the last few months, we said... This console will be great for families, be great people that love Nintendo, but it will work for us if they really adopt and bring in indie developers. And they showcased that they are going to do that. They talked about some different games that are coming out. Stardew Valley, one of the most popular indie games of all time, is going to come out on the Switch. Yooka-Laylee, which I know, Thomas, you've been following a little bit of. They did their Kickstarter on it. That's going to be a Switch title.
It's interesting. I was kind of wondering how that worked with the Kickstarter and if they're getting backing from Nintendo. It's not really important.
But the thing is, these games aren't coming out yet. So there's games like Fast RMX that people are crazy about. Shovel Knight, which everyone loves.
Shovel Knight's a great game.
Yeah, really, really cool kind of flip on the genre. These are the titles you want. There's 40 of them coming out, and they're indie titles that supposedly use the Joy-Cons and the new innovation that this console offers. If you are on the fence about getting this, if you're wondering if the $400 price tag really works for you, Zach Fanny, what do you say to those people that got a kid that really wants it, or maybe, you know, just want to get a new console, new year, new me, you know, they want a new console. What do you say to them?
Wait till you have an actual use for it. I think if you are a Nintendo fan, you would have had this pre-ordered already. Mm-hmm. At this point, if you don't have it, then you probably don't need it right away.
Yeah.
You can wait.
Thomas, what do you think? Because I know you're a little more...
You know, honestly, I pretty much agree with Zach. I'm a black hole. We got it. Don't kill the joke, Andy. No, I pretty much agree with Zach. It's the price point's not terrible, but until there's something that you really, really need for it, I think it's worth waiting, holding off for a little bit.
It's a tough one just because Zelda is so big for so many people. Like, if this was Mass Effect, I'd be buying this, you know? But it means a lot to a lot of people, and I understand that connection. Speaking of connections, next up, we are going to talk extensively about the country of Bolivia here on VGS.
You're listening to Video Game Sophistry with Andy Barkowski on Talk Radio, AM 640.
A lot of times in the world of video games, we're transported to fantastical lands, whether it is in a galaxy far, far away, mystical lands with elves and dwarves and golden dragons of death and fire. But more often than not, I think we go to places that are tropical and different, whether it is to, like we're hearing right now, kind of Red Dead, a turn of the century Western America, whether it is the new techno prog of Deus Ex, or in the upcoming Ghost Recon Wildlands, the beautiful vistas of the country of Bolivia. If you're not familiar, Ghost Recon Wildlands is coming out this week, and it sets you in the role of one of the ghosts, one of the supreme operatives that are basically the SEAL Team 6 superheroes. If you've seen a movie directed by Michael Bay, and there's some grizzled white people with one black character that says stuff like, yeah, let's get this done, those are the type of people that you're, you know, dealing with. These are the type of characters. Real hard-nosed, stereotypical. And they're trying to kill members of a drug cartel. In this fictional world, the country of Bolivia, though, has been completely corrupted. So much so that the military is actually acting as the police force that tries to kill you if you are just doing anything. If they see you, not even if you're doing anything bad, just if they see you. I'm joined, of course, by Zach Fanny, Thomas Hyde. We had a chance to play the game. We really enjoyed it.
Yeah, mechanically, it's a lot of fun, but I think like the crime it really commits is that it just kind of takes on like all this, you know, history of colonization and bilateral interference of the American government, and just takes it on uncritically, so that you're playing, you know, grizzled Navy SEALs that are, you know, swearing like they're 12-year-old boys.
Mm-hmm.
And it just assumes that you are the force of good, and so it seems inherently patronizing to like the host country, right? Like, oh, they have a tinge of ethnicity, so we can like steal their cars, and like, oh, we damaged some stuff, but in the end we're saving them from the terrible cartel and the armed forces. There's no developed government or real culture at all.
And that perceived insensitivity to the host country, we know, is not perceived, because a formal complaint, as you heard by News of the Week, has been filed to the French government from the interior minister of Bolivia, that is upset with Ubisoft, and it's to the French government because Ubisoft is located there, to the inaccurate portrayal of Bolivia, of their country. So much so that they're threatening legal action. The interior minister said that they have a standing to take legal action, but they prefer to resolve the issue through a diplomatic negotiation. Ubisoft, being open-minded and wonderful, gave a very corporate answer that I think leaves a lot wanting. This is the official byline saying, Imagine a different reality than the one that exists in Bolivia today, adding that they hope that the in-game world comes close to representing the country's beautiful topography. So this is the Eurocentric answer when someone from another country far, far away says legitimately, you know, not everyone that lives here is in dirt shacks, listens to rumba music, and there's no three-story buildings.
We have more things here than sweet mountains.
Yeah, more than that. So, of course, Ubisoft responds by saying, don't worry, your mountains look great.
Those rivers? You're going to love them.
Normally, when there's a sense of censorship in games, a lot of people really jump to the defense of the artist, saying this is their artistic integrity. They have an ability to create a fictional representation of whatever it is. I think from what we played of the game, it's just a beta, and from what we've seen, there's enough here to really ask yourself some difficult questions about what you expect from your games. Zach, do you think, and you've already kind of gilded a little bit here, but do you think that they've gone a little too far?
I think they've shown,
or at least Bolivian, has a point.
They've kind of slouched there. Like, it's a criminal laziness of just, it plays like the story and the characters and like what you're doing. It plays like a really terrible fan fiction of like a Vince Flynn.
Oh.
Vince Vaughn's writing books now. A Vince Flynn or like Lee Child book, where it's like, oh,
Rounders,
yeah, there's just too much red tape for this American hero. Yeah. He's going to come in there and, you know, introduce law and order to this poor, you know, slightly ethnic, you know, third world-esque country. And so you don't even get a sense of Bolivia being Bolivia. Like, for all you know, it could be just some made up, you know, country that
which
you're
is,
playing in.
Yeah,
right?
Which I think is the really unfortunate thing. And it's ironic, because let's go back now almost 10 years. A game from Pandemic, may it rest in peace, who I loved. I know, Thomas Hyde, you know this game too. Mercenaries 2, an incredible open world game that for me is a lot better than Ghost Recon. But when that came out, they got a because it was set in Venezuela. They got a letter from the Venezuelan government to the U.S. government saying that they are trying to build propaganda so they can convince people to invade and take out Hugo Chavez. Man, he must have been pissed, eh?
He got his pre-order. He's like, oh, I took off Friday. I'm going to start this game. Oh, hey, wait a minute. Wait,
I'm the bad guy?
I'm the butt of this joke?
What? So it's a little bit different, but I think that is a great barometer for what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
Because this game, Mercenaries 2, was almost like Just Cause in its zany, over-the-top way that you use your weapons and guns and how you interact with the world was insane. They had no airs about them whatsoever. And I think that way of playing the world really helps you understand the tone of the game.
Well, it kind of adopts, you know, a real place into its own fictional drive. Like, that game has a purpose. It's hyperbole for the purpose of satire in a lot of ways. And then in Ghost Recon, it's just so deadpan, you know, again, like this lazy. It doesn't really, I don't think it intends to come off as kind of Eurocentric and a little bit colonialist, but it does because it just assumes these old, tired, obsolete frameworks for understanding how American military forces interact with other countries.
But totally, don't you think the game as well could have, because the game's tone is all over the place.
Yeah.
Had it picked a side and really wanted to be a hard-nosed Tom Clancy Ghost Recon game,
right,
didn't have as much of the wacky gamey stuff, and maybe tried to, you know, tell a story that was more on the line with that, that it wouldn't be as criminal in its interpretation of this country. I think if they chose either one,
you could
maybe give them a little more leeway.
There's more artistic intent if that was the case, right? Which you could understand. Like, okay, they're using this to express a certain point or, you know, explore a particular theme in some way. And from what we've seen in the beta, that's not really the case. It's just, you know, we call it Bolivia because it's a real place and it's a place people you probably won't know. And then we can just kind of graph onto
it's it. It's so odd. Because there's not as if there's landmarks or anything.
Right.
Like there's beautiful mountains.
Well, it's a copy-pasted towns. Like, it's the same repeated, you know, ramshackle towns and, you know, some beautiful vistas and topography, but I doubt they were going to Bolivia to really like research of like, okay, how are we going to represent them in this game? It's really, that's the kind of what's the problem here is that they're appropriating a real place and culture into their crappy little, you know, American military adventure without having any sense of responsibility for the country that they're using and the people that they're using.
What do you think? If you're listening right now and just getting fuming saying, games are art, you should never put tape over someone's mouth with the word stop written on a marker because you don't like what it says, hopefully don't talk to us. But if you do have some kind of idea, send us a message, vgs@640toronto.com, Video Game Sophistry on YouTube, and of course on the Twitters @vgs_640. When we return, I will share my most persuasive piece of information that I've discovered this week as to why Mass Effect Andromeda has my attention and maybe has my heart. We'll be back after this.
This is VGS with Andy Barkowski on Talk Radio, AM 640.
If you're a fan of the show, or if you've been happening to driving through the GTA and flip through the switches Sunday evening, chances are you've heard me say the words Mass Effect. On the program, we've had writers like Drew Karpyshyn that first came up with the original ideas with the team. Patrick Weeks that really took it, kind of grabbed it by the throat and said, these stories need to tell more. Some individual stories about characters like Liara, John Dumbrow, which is a great interview, one of the masterminds behind all this. So we know a lot about the games and the games that BioWare makes, what they bring to the table and why they're special. You've heard me talk a lot about Andromeda and what I'm excited about. This week, the folks at Mass Effect released a new video that doesn't really have any combat in it, doesn't really have any exposition in it, doesn't have any fancy cutscenes. It's 5 minutes that has been more compelling to get me to care about this game than the last 2 hours that they've released pit and parcel over the last 2 years. And that's because they're actually going to show us what it's like to live in the world. I'm joined today, of course, by Professor Fanny, Thomas Hyde, some Mass Effect heads there. So right off the bat, Zach, what's the first thing you get to see in this new exploration and discovery video from Mass Effect that really blows you away?
You get to see how you move throughout the galaxy, and it's not just, you know, the traditional galaxy map that we are familiar with. You get to see what it's like to actually explore something that's new. Mm-hmm. And so one of the cool details that we noticed is that when you pull up to a new planet that you're going to then, you know, send probes to, you're going to do small missions for, you get to actually walk across your ship, look out the window, and see the planet outside.
And it looks incredible. Yeah. It looks unbelievable. That sense of transportation and scale.
Just the idea that you have like the galaxy map, and then when you walk into the window, you see what you were planning on the map. Like that, it seems like a small detail, but like that makes it so much more immersive for me than the previous games.
Absolutely, because you'll get to see, like, I'm going there. Yeah. I came from there. I'm going there. There's not these loading screens that are stopping me. We got to hear there's 100 different planets that you can interact with in the Helios cluster, a handful you can explore. So it's very similar to what we've seen so far here, what we're used to, I guess, for scanning. But when you arrive on the planet, you are there at the behest of the Andromeda Initiative. So you have the role of the Pathfinder. You're trying to find a colonization for your ship, the Hyperion, that I think has 300,000 human souls on it and various other species, all with this major nexus that is kind of the fulcrum of this adventure into a new galaxy. Once you get there, the Krogan ships have kind of already landed in their example, this planet called Elladin, and they've created what they have dubbed, according to the map, as New Tuchunka, which everyone knows as the other, the Krogan homeworld. So I've talked a lot about it. I've kind of set the stage for you, Fanny. We've explored other planets before in different Mass Effect games.
Yeah.
Right off the bat, what is different about exploring Elladin, New Tuchunka?
That you get a real sense of possibility, that now the choices that I'm going to make when I land onto this new planet are going to have real impact, because I'm at kind of the starting point for a new turn in history. So it's kind of like you can think about like Cartier coming to the new world, right? Like I'm
same
coming
to Champlain, baby.
Oh, great 10 history. Yeah.
That's it. Yeah.
arriving on the new shore. And even like the phrase, like it's kind of, you know, on the surface, the new Tuchunga, New York, right? Those kinds of motifs that are used here of colonization, where you arrive with a sense of responsibility, whereas in the previous Mass Effect games you arrive to planets with a sense that you are a cog in a larger machine. Here you have an amazing amount of determinative power as a player, which they mentioned, right? Like how you interact with a Krogan on Elladin is going to impact how you can proceed on that planet, how your ship's going to react to it, how you're going to get resources from it. And so you have to kind of contextualize all your behavior with, you know, what you need and balance that with what you think is ethical, and kind of use that balance to work toward a common future that you want to enact.
They introduced something called viability. So when you played the other games, there would be 1,000 different things you could do on this planet, and a lot of it was very disparate with the main story. We need to stop the Reapers. Let me just look for some minerals in this corner pocket.
It's hard to find.
It doesn't make a lot of sense. In this game, there's a real reason for it. And once you do reach a planet to 100%, or I think in the trailer they mentioned 40% viability, you can build a outpost there for the Initiative. Then in the video, we heard probably what I think is the most persuasive, most exciting new thing about Mass Effect Andromeda.
Reaching thresholds will allow you to upgrade the Nexus and wake up more colonists from cryosleep. Who you decide to wake up will determine what perks and advantages you'll get. Will you wake up scientists to give you an edge in research and development? Military personnel to give you an edge in combat? Or merchants to give you a leg up when trading?
So this is beyond cool. They have added a metagame into Mass Effect Andromeda. So not only do all of your choices really matter for the meaningful narrative experiences that we're used to in Mass Effect, for the meaningful narrative experiences that we get with the notion that we're building a new world, but this is how we're going to build the galaxy, because the choices we make will allow us the opportunity to pick who we want for our team, for the team in this world. It's a brilliant idea, kind of like Metal Gear Solid, what they did with Mother Base, the last Kojima project.
Right.
Like it is similar. There's some influences there. But I did not suspect that ever, that this would be a new added feature. And I don't know, why do you think that's so just exciting? Why do you think that adds so much? Because we're on the same boat, right? I'm speaking for you, a bit.
Yeah, yeah. No, very, very much so. That's why I'm here. I think it's because it's kind of one of the most perfect marriages that we've seen of gameplay and narrative, right? Mm-hmm. Like the player agency ties in directly to the mission that you have of colonizing new worlds. So like you are at the kind of the fulcrum of history, and so like having that kind of cohesion in a game is so exciting for me, because it means that when I'm mining minerals, you know, the thing I hate the most, but I'm still gonna do a ton of, right, even that will have an impact with the larger mission and goals I have for, you know, colonization and advancement for civilization. And so everything ties and relates to each other, and I think that's really hard to do in a game where you're balancing a lot of different, you know, ideas and mechanics, and to see it kind of maybe pulled off here is really exciting.
Now, that isn't to say that there could be some real pitfalls here. We talked about this off camera a lot. This is a game that is about colonization. Mm-hmm. So I think if we look at our national history and North America's history, there is a legacy of taking advantage of disenfranchised groups in order to have your ethnicity reign supreme. We have it in Canada. We definitely have it in the United States. I think BioWare, they're located in Edmonton, their home base, which has dealt with a lot of these problems historically. Mm-hmm. It's a big part of our national identity. If they don't deal with that, the hard questions, because you need to colonize for all of humanity, there are some real hard questions about whether or not you would exterminate passively 100,000 people to save 20 million. It's not the more nebulous choices that we heard with the Reapers, where all of the Paragon Renegade choices, you would always go Paragon because you never really lost anything. Let's not have the idea of loss or gain, but moreover, the realism of what it would be like to colonize a new world. If they do that even a little bit, if they capture just a bit of that,
like
essence,
interacting with, with, like,
that would be
alien subjectivity. Like, what? Like, how can you possibly use a framework that is now obsolete to, you know, interpret completely new experiences?
Think about what that would mean for us as Canadians, as Americans, to play a game that would make us understand a little more what it was like for the foundation of our country or any of these colonialized places we live in. I think they really have the potential to do that. You know, will they succeed? Do you think that's something they'll flirt with? Because it's such a ridiculously controversial idea.
I really hope it does. Like, that's kind of the power of this game for me, is can we take this theme and explore its dimensions and not just fight, you know, a nebulous bad guy. I think that the appeal of this game is that it kind of enacts the state of nature thought experiment, right? Which is like the old liberal idea from, you know, Rousseau, Locke, and Hobbes, where, you know, the idea that if we're all, if we're all thrown in nature in the wild together, what kind of society do we form? And I think that is kind of the starting point for political and social philosophy. And this game has the potential to raise those questions in an environment where we can actually make choices and enact the civilization we want to have.
There are less than 20 days until all these these questions will be answered. Andy Brakowski, Zach Fanny, Thomas Hyde here on VGS. We certainly hope here on VGS that if you did grab a Nintendo Switch, that you are enjoying it. We're probably going to wait a little bit. Mass Effect Andromeda is coming out soon, next week. We've done it before. Probably going to have a Mass Effect heavy show because got an interview with someone on the team. You've probably seen him on the Twitters, Mike Gamble. He's going to be talking to us this week and maybe even have some of the Mass Effect elite influencers on. We'll see what happens.
So you've talked to every staff member at BioWare at this point.
Almost everyone that like walks in the BioWare building, they're like, oh, you gotta call Andy.
Yeah. Right. Here's the card.
That's it. Make sure you follow us on the Twitters, VGS. What is it again? Anybody know?
Nope.
Excellent.
At Zach is great. Twitter.com.
You don't know who owns that.
Go to YouTube, Video Game Sophistry, and of course on Facebook. Just type in VGS and you'll see all our pretty faces. I'm Andy Brakowski.
Zach Fanny.
And I'm Thomas Hyde.
And this is VGS.
without a doubt, the worst episode ever. Rest assured that I was on the internet within minutes, registering my disgust throughout the world.